To make high-end headphones, an injection molding machine first makes plastic back covers. The mesh area will allow sound waves to pass through instead of reflecting back into the headphone. Down the line, equipment stamps trademark and other information onto two more casing components, a decorative metal disc and a plastic housing. The next machine winds copper wire that's as thin as a human hair around a cylinder hundreds of times. The winding is computer controlled to produce a critical component, the headphone's voice coil. When magnetized by an incoming signal, the voice coil vibrates a diaphragm, causing it to emit sound. That diaphragm now takes shape as a press applies heat and pressure to a plastic membrane. These tools mold the plastic thicker in the center and thinner around the outer zone for a wide and flat audio frequency range. A technician punches out the molded shape. She applies a bead of glue to the diaphragm, then positions the copper voice coil in an assembly device. She aligns the glued section of the diaphragm with the coil. Ultraviolet light activates the glue to seal the coil to the diaphragm. The plastic housings each contain a magnet. The next technician installs the diaphragm and voice coil assembly on that housing. This takes skill because the coil must be positioned precisely for the best sound quality. And this headphone speaker is now ready for an audio check. A technician tests the audio frequency range, distortion, and other factors. Here, a technician joins the ends of curved wires in a plastic clip. These wires serve a dual function. They hold the headphones snugly over the ears and deliver audio signals from the left side of the headphones to the right. The next technician installs a connector for the headphone's audio cable in a plastic strain relief. An adjustable band will allow the headphones to fit on heads of all shapes and sizes. The operator presses the parts together with a hydraulic tool. Moving down the line, a technician now joins the two halves of the speaker housing. She forces the two parts together with a pneumatic tool and finishes it off with a decorative metal ring. She inserts the speaker mechanism in the center of the housing, then places plastic brackets over it for protection. She then secures the entire assembly to the housing. Next, she solders two wires to each headphone speaker. A plastic ring and cover protect it while still allowing the wires to protrude. She attaches the end of the headband to the speakers, then solders the wires from the speaker to those protruding from the headband. She presses a plastic grill into place over each speaker, very carefully, to prevent scratching. These headphones are now wired and ready for audio. And whether it's rock or classical, the choice of music will be silent to all but one individual. People have been doing mic checks since 1876, when the microphone was invented as part of the telephone. Microphones convert sound to a signal that can be transmitted through televisions, radios, and many other things. If you have something to say, you'll need a microphone to broadcast it. From the glory days of radio to stage and screen and the digital age, the microphone has been at the center of it all. To make a broadcast quality microphone, they start with a support piece for it. Automated tools carve a brass cylinder to the desired dimensions. They also make a retainer ring for the microphone grill that will anchor the grill's metal mesh. They layer three sheets of mesh and align them. Then they solder the three sheets together. A punch press forms the soldered mesh into a concave shape. They lower a blade to slice the shaped mesh in half. The two pieces will be used to make one microphone grill. An assembler squeezes solder paste into a groove in the brass ring. Then he presses the grill halves, which have been joined by a bracket, into the solder-coated ring. On a carousel, a torch heats the rings, and the solder paste melts to bond the grills to the rings. A drill punctures a brass disc up to 90 times to make ventilation holes. Another tool levels the surface and shaves off unwanted bits. This disc will be the backplate for one of the microphone's capsules. An assembler brushes away any remaining shavings and then fixes the backplate in a holding device. This plastic membrane has been coated with real gold to conduct electricity. She places the membrane and a plastic ring on the backplate and then attaches an electrical lead. She screws the plastic ring down to secure the assembly, and then trims away the excess plastic membrane. This microphone capsule is now complete. Next, she'll join two capsules to create the unit that's the heart of the microphone. It converts sound into an electrical signal. An aluminum spacer goes between the capsules, which face back to back. Two capsules instead of one means this microphone can be switched to pick up audio from various directions. A plastic bracket reinforces the assembly. A technician then wires the brass support piece that we saw being made earlier to the electronics system, and then he secures it with screws. After installing switches, he inserts the microphone capsules in the grill. He screws the capsule assembly to the grill and joins it to the electronics. He slides the metal casing over the electronics and secures the microphone with a big screw cap. He checks the switch that changes the directionality of the mic, and now it's ready for a sound check. The mic goes into a special anechoic chamber. A computer measures its response to various audio frequencies and directions. Once a microphone has passed this test and some other checks, it's time to pack it up with great care, because this mic is delicate and worth several thousand dollars. Treated properly, this microphone should last several decades. In showbiz, that's longevity.